night to get a handle on Picasso, to have your introductory toe in the warm pool of Picasso. Our presenter is Dr. Sarah Archino. She's an associate professor of art. She's also the chair of the Furman Art Department. She specializes in 20th century American art with a particular focus on works from New York. Her scholarship weaves together the avant-garde circles of the World War I era with a particular interest in the emergence of Dadaism. Some of you probably know Dadaism, and some of you think it's childish babbling. She also has published on the use of humor in art and on creative interventions with archives, where you're using vast collections and finding creative and new ways to use these great collections. As chair of the art department, her work also includes research into the instruction on visual literacy. As an English teacher myself, I always, when asked what I did, I taught students how to read, how to write, how to listen, and how to speak. That's basically what an English class does: reading, writing, listening, and speaking. Well, one of the things you learn to read are pictures, drawings, cartoons, imagery. This whole idea of studying images to see how images can manipulate us, I think is very important for young people who live in a world with so much imagery. So they can read it successfully, see what's going on, you know, behind the scenes. So, her current writing project, back to Dr. Archino, her current writing project examines the use of parafiction, which is the merging of fact and fiction. Can you imagine people merging fact and fiction? I just can't imagine such a thing ever happens. Focusing particularly on works by Stephen Colbert. So, with that in mind, it is my pleasure to introduce a doorway into the life of Picasso, Dr. Sarah Archino.
Well, thank you so much. I wish, Larry, you could come and introduce me all the time. That was a really generous appraisal of the work that I do. And thank you, Laura, for inviting me. Laura, I'm delighted to be part of the events and to know more about what happens with Chautauqua. It sounds like a lot of fun. And I'm looking forward to meeting Picasso in the winter. My goal tonight, I've got a couple of things that I hope to do during the time that we have together. As Larry mentioned, I'm a specialist in Dada art, which is around the time that Picasso is working, but an approach to art that kind of questions everything, and that brings a level of skepticism and tries to think about art in ways that are slightly irreverent. And so I hope you'll indulge me a little bit in this point of view as we're talking about Picasso tonight. I thought about subtitling this paper, Five Easy Steps to Becoming a Genius. But I'm hoping tonight to talk about Picasso, but also to talk about why are we still talking about Picasso? Why 100 years later is he somebody that we keep coming back to? Even as complicated a figure as he is and the challenges that he puts out for us in his personal life, he's still this revolutionary figure that changes the way we think about art and in turn the way we think about the world. So, to commemorate the 50th anniversary of Picasso's death, the New York Times ran this really fun interactive piece that asked the reader to choose between love him or hate him. And as you clicked on one or the other, the critic, Deborah Solomon, began each essay with the phrase, "Today I love him," or "Today I hate him." And there's something really deeply identifiable for me about that approach, and something that I'm hoping to balance as we talk about today, because in the 21st century, it's difficult to talk about Picasso without at least acknowledging that there were elements of his life that were misogynistic or colonistic. There were areas his biographers have mentioned his often cruel behavior to people and women in his life. And yet, we still need to talk about him, right? And how do we balance the fact that our current day discomfort with some of these elements of Picasso's life cannot, we can't imagine a telling of modern art without the work that he's doing, right? So how do we kind of weave our way through that? And part of the problem is Picasso talked about his life and his art as being a kind of diary, right? He identified so closely his lived life and the work he was creating. So I'm hoping tonight to do a balancing act, not unlike what Deborah Solomon did in the New York Times, and to balance out some of the more uncomfortable facts of Picasso's life with the amazing contributions, and to talk us through those contributions to modern art. When I teach Picasso at Furman, we often actually start with this image, which is not Picasso at all, but Antonio Banderas. And we talk about what it is in this staged photograph that they hope conveys an idea of genius, right? This was a mini series on the Nat Geo channel, and they chose Picasso and framed him in this way as this brooding, intense figure, right? Who's so engulfed by the process of painting that he doesn't seem to realize he's covered in paint, and that he leans forward and looks kind of through us and past us. How is this idea of genius bound up with the artwork? So, this is part of the challenge that Picasso presents to us. The other part of the challenge is that he created over the course of his lifetime over tens of thousands of works, from paintings to sculptures to prints to drawings to works that are textiles and installations to theater scenes. I mean, there's absolutely no way to be comprehensive in talking about his work. And as we'll see tonight, he has such a variety of styles that it's a difficult thing to sort of encapsulate any one way that he approached his work. In fact, his is kind of that defies our categories, and I think is part of the reason that we're still talking about Picasso as a genius. So, what I'd like to do in the time that I have with you all tonight is to go through some of the different styles, some of the different innovations that Picasso takes on in the first half of his career. I'm not even going to touch the second half of his life, because Picasso continues producing work until his death in 1973. Right, cycling through different styles, like this kind of fin de siècle symbolist painting, his blue period, his rose period, analytical cubism, collage, classicism, synthetic cubism. Like Jackson Pollock once said, this guy missed nothing. So today, these are some of the works that I'm going to be talking about, focusing again on that first half of Picasso's career, and not just because it was during these years that he's making these foundational leaps in painting and doing the kind of work that cements his legacy, but also because these can often be difficult styles to approach. Cubism is one of those spots in modern art where people's skepticism starts to spike. I'm hoping that by the end of this evening, I can present an idea that there's at least a different kind of engagement here with the real world. That we're looking at here an artist who is thinking about the process of making art and moving beyond the idea that art needs to look like the thing it represents. This is not unique to Picasso. At the beginning of the 20th century, artists are exploring this idea that you can represent more about an object than just its visual appearance. appearance. How else might we describe a glass? This for me, and this is a detail from one of the collages that we'll see later this evening, and this is indeed a sort of alphabet, a letter in the alphabet of Cubism that depicts Picasso's rendering of a glass. This is where I think Picasso is really making a contribution that spans all of his stylistic chameleon ways, by pushing us to consider how an artwork makes meaning, how it shows us something, aside from just being a mimetic representation of what we see every day. Picasso famously claimed, "Art is the lie that tells the truth." So, how do we do this? How do we go about this? You know, how do you become a genius in 5 easy steps? I'll start with a bit of biography, and I think step one is simply to be precocious. Pablo Picasso was born in 1881 to an artistic family living in Spain. And the story goes that the first word Picasso ever said was pencil, and that he could draw well before he could speak. Now, that's the kind of story that definitely sounds apocryphal at best. But maybe there's a grain of possibility. I mean, Picasso, as an infant, spent his days in the studio of his father, who was an academic painter and a painting instructor. And then maybe it was possible that Picasso mimicked the simple pis. That's short for lapis, the Spanish word for pencil. I mean, maybe. We do know something that would seem equally apocryphal, that as a child, Picasso mastered what we think of as the foundations of Western art academic training. He was not necessarily a good student. He spent his school days drawing in the margins of his books. There's lots of great examples of doodles at the Musée Picasso in Paris. But his father did recognize an early talent and sent his son for formal training so that by the age of 11, Picasso had been accepted as a student at the School of Fine and Applied Arts, and this drawing of a plaster cast was made right around that time. And it demonstrates his ability to really render with a degree of accuracy and a degree of sensitivity anatomy in a way that we might not expect when we see his later work. By 13, Picasso was working in oils and selling his work. At the age of 14, his family moved to Barcelona, where his father took a job teaching there at the School of Fine Arts. And although he was still quite young, Picasso took the entrance exams for the school. It was a series of tasks that usually required a month's worth of work. And according to which source you read, Picasso completed it in either one day or one week. But either way, we know he was admitted as an exceptionally young student. But once again, not a diligent student. And he spent most of his days painting in a studio that his family rented for him in a rather questionable neighborhood around a street called Avignon, which we'll return to in a couple of minutes. He then moved to Madrid, where he was accepted into the more prestigious Royal Academy of Fine Arts. But instead of attending class, Picasso frequently attended the Prado. And going through the museum, he admired paintings by Spanish Baroque artists, works like Velázquez's Water Cellar, or Giuseppe Ribera's portraits and pictures of saints. And I think when we look at this early painting by Picasso of this old fisherman, a model that his family hired for him, we can see some of that sensitivity and some of that virtuosity. He's copying from these Baroque masters and creating a sense of character study, right? Where our focus is on a sort of a pathos of this figure, not a portrait in a conventional sense, certainly nothing about status, but a sense of character. Picasso could have followed this much more traditional route, but as young folks do at the age of 18, he moved away from these traditional roots and joined a group that referred to themselves as the Modernistas, a young group of artists and writers who met at a tavern, the Four Cats. We can see here actually a menu that Picasso designed for that tavern, which was a signal even here in his first years of being part of that group of how well regarded he was. He was given sort of the plum artist task of designing the menu. And it was here that he had his first public exhibition as well. Many members of the group circled around the Four Cats were involved in radical politics and anarchism. And while scholars are of mixed opinion about Picasso's own politics and political allegiances, we can trace the impact of these political conversations on the choice of his early subjects. Picasso increasingly spending his time depicting those who were marginalized, the poor, the ill, the nightlife, folks that lived on the edges of proper society. If I was writing my self-help guide, this would be step two to becoming a genius, surpass your father. Because with his precocious rise, Picasso had eclipsed the artistic reputation of his father by the first decade of the 20th century. And we see him moving to Paris. He makes four trips to Paris before he settles there in 1904. But he was noticed right away, even in a city of artistic talent. And his first show in 1901, where this was doubtlessly one of the paintings shown, a critic referred to him as a, quote, brilliant newcomer, qualifying his praise by saying, quote, Picasso's passionate surge forward has not yet left him the leisure to form a personal style. That would not be a problem for long. As we see, Picasso begins at this point a sort of dizzying practice as the stylistic polymath working through a set of core images. So having mastered the technique of his own biological father, we'll look at some of the other artistic fathers that he takes on. Picasso's Blue Period is often pointed to as one of his first unique styles, right? Developing his own artistic voice. And biographically, we often talk about the Blue Period as being a moment in Picasso's own personal life that was difficult. He lost a close friend to suicide. He is poor. He's trying to find his way. And definitely, there are images in this series that reflect that searching, that melancholy, that sadness. But there are also other influences at play. While Picasso was skipping school and hanging out at the Prado, we know he was also looking at the paintings of El Greco, for example. And we can see some similarities between this crouching woman from Picasso's Blue Period, which has that sense of melancholy, which has that sense of destitution, but that also pulls from the example of El Greco some 400 years earlier. Through this heavy use of outline, the contorted body, which El Greco, as a mannerist painter, used to depict a sense of earthly torment and often, as you know, this example of St. Francis playing, to suggest not just earthly torment, but a kind of spiritual ascension, right? Something that rose above. And we see Picasso in this period similarly distorting his figures in this sort of wash of a madman that we see here on the right. We can see an echo of El Greco, right? The elongation of the figure, especially when we look at the hands and the feet. Both of these artists are creating an otherworldly character. El Greco to emphasize divinity, Picasso to emphasize a sort of modern isolation and an illness. Right? Both of them distorting, but with intent. And it's that intent that I want to underscore In 1905, Picasso shifted from his blue period to what's commonly referred to as his rose period. Which is a bit of a misnomer. Really, it's more of a terracotta period, but I guess that's not as poetic. Critics at the time talk about how this palette feels very Mediterranean. It feels like a fresco with this sort of wash tones and these warm colors. The palette changes, but the subjects still remain lingering at the margins. And often, as we see here in this rose period, Picasso paints figures who live on the edge. Acrobats, clowns who performed in a local circus. Although he doesn't really show them as performers, instead we see them in these recognizable costumes, but moving through these minimalist spaces that seem to isolate them even more. At the same time that we know he's studying these circus performers, he's also thinking back to traditions of the Commedia dell'arte and a kind of classical trajectory of figures like the Harlequin, who he often identified and, in this example, gives his own facial features to that figure of the Harlequin. Like a young Picasso, these were people who lived on the margins of respectable Parisian society. And as outsiders, they were people whose occupations became part of their identity, at least to the outside world. But where I want to spend my time, because I have a limited amount of time with y'all tonight, is looking at the work that really challenges the way we see. And so I want to spend some time talking through how we get to cubism, right? Because that is really the challenge before us. And I want to start with this portrait of Gertrude Stein. Because I think we can see here how Picasso begins to move from a real person to making an icon, right? Making a symbol for a person. Gertrude Stein, as I'm sure you might know, is an experimental American portrait. She lived in, poet. In these years, she lived in Paris with her brother Leo, and the two were really important collectors who supported Picasso at a time when few others did. When the Steins hung Picasso's paintings in their home, it not just paid the bills, but it also gave him a kind of intellectual legitimacy to be accepted into this avant-garde circle. And so, as a gesture of thank you and mutual respect, Picasso set about to paint this portrait of Gertrude Stein. And it starts, you know, ordinarily enough with the poet posing, but it became quickly a work that was frustrating for Picasso. And we know that Gertrude Stein writes, she sat for him some 80 times. That's a lot of just sitting. And after 80 sessions, Picasso abandoned the work. He was frustrated by it, particularly by, as we might guess from looking at this, the face. So he leaves the work, and he goes away to the summer. That summer, Picasso returns to Spain, and he goes to this tiny village out in the Pyrenees. And in this environment, in this escape where he's reeling from his frustrations of failing to paint a really important portrait, we know that he started looking at local ancient Iberian sculptures. There was an archaeological dig not far from Picasso's hometown that was unearthing these small statuettes. We also know around this period he starts looking at African art. And he's not so much interested in the history of these objects as he is the way that they represent the human figure with a sense of energy. Right, and with an abstract depiction of the body. And so the story goes that Picasso spends this summer away. He returns to Paris in the fall of 1906, and then he paints the rest of this portrait without Gertrude Stein. And he resolves the problem by creating here this kind of mask-like face. The longer we look at the face of Gertrude Stein in this image, the more it seems misaligned with the rest of her body. The more we might notice, for example, the heavy rims he places around the eyes, and how when we look through those eyelids, the eyes don't seem to be quite behind. There's a kind of disconnect. We have this sharp hairline, a sharp jawline that is recognizably human and yet somehow also inanimate. It has a kind of stillness to it. If this was where, if I was writing my guide to being a genius, I think we could move on to step three, which is start taking on history. So we see Picasso at this moment looking at Iberian carvings. We see him at this moment looking at African carvings. And we see him looking also at a French history of painting. Artists like Ingres, whose portrait of Monsieur Bertin hangs today in the Met in New York. And he starts copying from this kind of trajectory a way of representing power and authority, right? Translating Gertrude Stein's body into this sort of pyramid, right, that leans forward. Or looking at Ingres' drawings and the way that in his pencil drawings, Ingres focused our attention on the head and the hands of his subject. And in between, often flattened the body to little more than an outline. And when we look at this portrait of Gertrude Stein, we start to see certain areas of her body, like that face, that seem highly three-dimensional. And then parts of her body, like her torso, or like that left hand, that start to look flat and two-dimensional instead. Famously, Picasso said, "This might not look like Gertrude Stein, but it will." Kind of does. Also, it might kind of come to look like Gertrude Stein because this might, the portrait of her might be the way most people think of her if you had to conjure up her image in her mind. So there's a lot of ways we can interpret Picasso's kind of sidestepping of likeness in predicting some future resemblance for Gertrude Stein. But I want to keep us on this pathway to cubism, and I want to talk about a painting that, for me, has always been a kind of visual stepping stone to what becomes really hard to read. And that's this 1906 painting by Picasso of two nudes. In this work, we can see a little bit more clearly the impact of those sculptures he's looking at, because these two figures look sculptural. They have a kind of blockiness, they have a kind of heaviness, even the way like the contours of their body are these forms that look like they've been carved from a single block of stone. These blocky kind of squat proportions also have a hint of this kind of archaic three-dimensionality. We can also see here more clearly how Picasso has transformed the faces into masks in a way that emphasizes a transition, right, between like live human, a sculpted form of the mask, and then the painted surface of the painting that we're looking at. Right? There's a sort of three-part transition happening between the person, the sculpture, and then our painting. But more than that, this idea of moving between two dimensions and three dimensions, I think we can really see it here. And I have this wireless mouse. I don't like standing behind. I'm just going to come out and talk. These two figures that seem so three-dimensional, that have this sense of mass and volume, right, are standing in front of a curtain. And I think the curtain is where it starts getting really interesting, because one of the problems that artists are grappling with in 1906 is admitting, or how do you admit as an artist, that you are trying to play a trick on the audience. Every painting is playing a trick on the audience, because we're creating the illusion of three dimensions on a two-dimensional canvas. Right? And artists have all kinds of tricks that you learn in art school and how to do that, how to make something look three-dimensional, right, when it's really a flat painted surface. Right? This curtain is, I think, a way we see Picasso trying to figure that out. And a curtain is a great subject for doing that. We can see the model on the left holds the curtain in her hand at the top, right? At the top of the screen, at the top of this painting, that curtain is a three-dimensional object. She's holding it, she's grabbing it, we see the shadows and the folds. Right? However, as we follow the line in between these two women, that curtain moves from being a three-dimensional object to a two-dimensional surface. And Picasso manages to make that transition visible in both places, right? We see it as a two-dimensional background and a three-dimensional object. A curtain is a great way to kind of work that out because a curtain kind of is a three-dimensional, two-dimensional thing. And so in these early paintings, we often see Picasso using that curtain as a way of thinking through space. And we see it in what is maybe one of his landmark radical leaps forward, the Demoiselle d'Avignon. And this is a painting that I could talk about forever with y'all, and I promise I will not go down all the rabbit holes we could. I just want to call our attention to the way he's using these curtains. And I know that's probably the least interesting part of this painting. We've got here five women, right? I'll give you the sort of general sketch. We're looking at a scene of five women in a brothel, right? Avignon is referenced in the title is not Avignon, the city in the south of France, but that Avignon neighborhood where he had a studio that was a kind of questionable red light district, right? So he's conjuring up here this scene of a brothel, these five women. We have all these sketches that Picasso did where he shows not just the women, but doctors, or a scientist holding a skull, or himself dressed as a sailor. We kind of know the story from those sketches. And famously, in the final version, Picasso creates this very frontal, very confrontational depiction of these women. And we could psychoanalyze this for a while, but we're just going to talk about the curtain. The five women are in a space that's between two curtains. Right? We can see the woman over here on the left is holding back a curtain with her upper hand. Right? We can see the fold of the curtain, and Picasso gives us the illusion of that folded back curtain. Right? You see the lighter against the darker. We then see her holding the curtain as it falls down here along the side with her other hand. So we can imagine a space where she's lifting back this curtain to reveal the women. And then we have another curtain in the background, which is this blue, that seems to define the back of the space that we're seeing. And we see another woman who sort of uses her hands to part the curtain and walk into the space. So what we're looking at here is really a kind of shallow space created by a red curtain in front, blue curtain in the back. However, these curtains don't stay two-dimensional, but rather they start to become space that's being depicted. What do I mean by this? Well, in some places, we can see how this curtain, for example, begins to merge with the body of this woman. So that instead of being just in front of her, it becomes hard to dissociate what is leg and what is curtain. As we look at the curtain in the background, it starts to become nearly indistinguishable from the cloth that covers these two women in the foreground. So that we're losing Picasso is making us lose our ability to tell for certain what's in the front, what's in the middle, and what's in the back. But that's because it's a painting. And I know that's like the obvious thing here to say. However, in a painting, space doesn't just happen. Space gets painted just as the objects in the painting do. Right? So what we're seeing here is Picasso painting that space with the same kind of presence as the objects in that space. And as we move to thinking about cubism, that back and forth becomes more and more visible. The other kind of father figure I want to point out is, of course, Cézanne. And here we're looking at the summer that cubism becomes cubism in 1909. Where we see here Picasso making again another trip away from Paris. Now he's in the south of France and painting this reservoir in a way that also seems to confuse the things that are closest to us with the things that are farthest away. Right? We have this kind of collapse of space. It's still at a point where we can recognize the objects. We can see the houses. We might be able to read that wall of the reservoir and then the reflection of the houses in the water. But it's all being painted on the surface of a canvas. And so even then, when we look at a photograph of the space, and this is a photograph that Picasso himself took and then sends to Gertrude Stein to show her where he's been working, we can see how it's kind of hard in this vantage point to read a sense of distance because the light here is so stark, right? Those houses in the background do seem just as sort of sharp and detailed and present as the houses in the foreground. So there is a way that Picasso is showing space that reflects how he's seeing it, but then he's also bringing into it this process of painting. So let's talk about proper cubism, right? By 1909, 1910, Picasso's reached a point that we refer to as analytical cubism. And that's the kind of stuff that we see, and it's like a puzzle to try to figure out what exactly we're looking at, right? Analytical cubism, we can think of through that word analytical, thinking about the process of analyzing an object, how we sort of break it down into its components. And I like to think of it as kind of like a schematic drawing, you know, that's going to break something into these different angles as a way of explaining to us a three-dimensional object in a simple two-dimensional drawing. In analytical cubism, we see that same process. We see here a figure, and I promise there's a figure here, trying to read the room on how many folks are feeling that yet. We have a figure that's being broken down, and that figure sits in a space that's being painted up. Right? So the result is sort of in the middle with this dematerialized figure sitting in a very active space. Picasso never wants to be so far away from reality that you can't read what he's doing. So he always gives us a title that tells us what we're looking at. And our title here tells us we're looking at a portrait of Daniel Henry Kahnweiler. Kahnweiler was his dealer at the moment. So again, another important person for Picasso to be depicting as a portrait. This was another sort of a way of signaling his arrival. However, now we have to do the work of reading the image. Before, when I showed that wine glass, I called it a letter in the alphabet. Picasso has a repertoire of symbols that are used over and over again. And in fact, if you look carefully, we can see here on the table to the side, perhaps the contours of a wine bottle, perhaps the contours of another glass. You can see the bowl of the glass here at the bottom. Like most conventional portraits, we're looking at here a seated figure. So maybe then we can start to pick out not really hands, but a series of parallel lines that crisscross with another series of parallel lines that, since we know we're looking for a figure, and since we can imagine a conventional portrait with their hands sitting in their lap, we use our context clues and we say, oh, hands. Right. At this point, Picasso's starting to think about how do we read an image, right? That idea of an alphabet becomes really important. So those don't look like hands just by themselves, but in the context of where they are and what we're looking for, we can start to interpret them. Right. And this idea of language is really important. There's a much later interview where Picasso explains, like, he doesn't read English, but he understands it's a language. And that cubism is the same kind of thing. Right? It's a language. So if we want to move up from the hands, we then might notice that there's a sort of concentration of dark shapes in the middle, like a suit jacket. Or maybe a series, if we want to work from the top, of curving lines that look like hair swept back. I'm hearing this. This is good. We're getting there, right? So you see the hair swept back. Now, those curving lines aren't all that different from this curving line, but now we can start to read like that curving line is a mustache. Not because it looks like a mustache so much as the fact that it's at the end of this long thing that looks kind of like a nose. And then we can tell, like, that's a mustache. That's a watch chain. Looks like the same thing, but we're using context and position to kind of fill in what it must be, right? Like, that's a really active, engaging process. And Picasso's looking for us to play that game with him. It's not something he's invented. It's other artists are kind of thinking about this kind of semiotics approach, right? How do things make meaning? We also do have here, mention the influence of those masks that he's looking at. And scholars have interpreted this shape in the upper right-hand corner to be a mask, not unlike the one that I'm including down here. We look at this mask and we know it's a face, not because it necessarily really looks like a face, but again, because we can read context clues and shape. Right? That's not really a great illusion of a nose and eyebrows, but we can read them as such because it's in this configuration. That's what Picasso's up to. Right? And we get really good at doing this. Like, this is a guitar. Of course it's a guitar, right? We could read it as a guitar. But if you start to look at each individual component, like, this is a terrible sound hole. If you're trying to think about what a sound hole would look like, right? A sound hole is a hole in the guitar that opens up into, like, the hollow inside of a guitar. Picasso's sound hole is a cylinder that sticks out. But we read it so easily as a sound hole, right? Like, we know how to, like, make that connection. We understand that these are strings on a neck, even though in Picasso's guitar, the neck is hollow and the strings are inside, not like how a real guitar would be shaped. We know to make the connection that this looks like wood. Even though it's not wood, it's cardboard. And then he later makes a version of it in steel. But we're able to make these adjustments little by little, or these steps to follow the connection between what we're seeing and what we can read it to be. In my last couple of minutes, and I want to leave time for questions and things, I just want to point to a couple other ways that Picasso plays this game. Because he doesn't want to be totally abstract that we can't read it. And I will say, in about 1911, he and George Brock, who he's working with, both start to feel like people cannot read what they're looking at anymore. Like, it's getting too far off the track. And so in 1912, Brock and Picasso both begin looking for a way to be more legible without going back to the old-fashioned ways of depicting things as they really are. And collage is a great way for Picasso to tackle this dilemma. We're looking at here his first collage. I guess technically we could call it an assemblage because it's got this rope that circles it, making it into like a three-dimensional object. As always, the title tells us what we're looking at. It's a still life with chair caning. And we see here a couple of objects that, with that cubist vocabulary, we can identify. So in the middle is another wine glass. There's a lot of wine glasses. Actually, doesn't sound so bad right now. So we see that wine glass in the center. And again, like a recognizable symbol, right? Now that we're starting to see it, it becomes easier to read in each successive painting. Next to that wine glass, we see this rectangle in gray with the letters J-O-U. It's a newspaper, right? The journal. It's also an invitation to play, because if you speak French, jouer is the word to play. And Picasso loved this pun. He uses this pun all the time. So that we get here this open invitation to start like figuring out what's going on here. We've also got a little scallop shell, a little piece of lemon. But the real thing that Picasso wants us to play with is the chair caning. And he calls it out in the title, right? Still life with chair caning. And you can imagine like a cafe table in France, we'll just imagine, with these caned chairs. So if we're thinking about what this painting shows us, it's a cafe table, right? And you can imagine the chair next to that table. Except that it's not real chair caning. And it's not a painting of chair caning. Rather, what it is Picasso has taken a piece of oilcloth. If you've ever been to like a pizza restaurant with the plasticky tablecloths, it's that kind of material. He's taken a piece of that oilcloth that was mechanically printed to look like chair caning, and he's pasted that to the surface of his canvas. So it's not the real thing, and it's not a painting of the real thing. It's a mass-produced tablecloth kind of image that sits somewhere in the middle of that, right? That's fun, right? Like that's playing with another way to tell us that we're looking at a chair without painting a chair, right? The whole thing is a painting like that because we get then this golden rope, and it's an actual piece of rope. He buys it from a hardware store that he uses that on one hand we can think of as a frame. You can imagine a nice gold frame, a little bit of carving around the painting. It also looks like the edge of a table, right? You know, especially like those cafe tables. Before I came to Furman, I lived in Paris for a couple of years, and these cafe tables are still pretty ubiquitous with the carved rope edging around the sides. It looks like a painting, and it looks like a table, and it's kind of both. And then when you throw in that, like, the French word for table is table and the French word for painting is tableau, it's like, oh, my God, it's got all the angles covered here. It's a painting that's a table that's a painting, and half of it he hasn't made himself. Like, that's a lot for us to unpack in this question of image and reality. What I want to end, though, with is this idea of stylistic change. Because all of these works, the cubism, the collage, the paintings, the play, the punning, the puzzles, are in the years building up to World War I. And in fact, the image I skipped has a newspaper clipping. Again, you can see the jeu, right, the game we're about to play, and the headline underneath it was "The battle has begun." A reference not just to, you know, this kind of artistic battle, but like the actual literal battles that were erupting in 1912, 1913, especially in Eastern Europe. In that environment, we start to see how Picasso moves away from one linear style and evolution. He is an alien resident living in France. Cubism is suddenly kind of suspicious as a little too cutting edge, a little too modern. Oddly enough, it becomes categorized as German, even though there were no German artists who were foundational in the Cubist style in these years. Something about the angularity and the non-classical quality, it becomes this bush. It's a sort of viewed suspiciously. And so Picasso returns to a more classical style, right? With drawings of his dealers, a beautiful, classical, flattering portrait of one of his wives. And a back and forth that I think makes him such a challenging artist to deal with. I mean, I've looked at just a fraction of what we could talk about tonight. These two Harlequin paintings, I think, are a great way of seeing side by side in the span of a few years how he's ping-ponging between styles. Right? That on one hand, we have a painting, it looks like a collage, but it's a painting. So it's again another kind of play on what we think we're looking at. That depicts the Harlequin, and we can see that characteristic diamond pattern. And then just at the same time to be painting these much more classical kind of melancholic images of the same figure. Over the next 5 decades, Picasso continues that back and forth. Right? And I think that's part of what makes him such a challenging artist and such an intriguing figure, is that there's no one way to think about how he approaches art other than this consciousness that he's creating an image. And that image has lots of ways to tell us what it's about. So with that, I will say thank you, and I'm happy to answer questions or to talk more about a work that we've seen here. I'm told we have the internet, so we can look at something that I didn't talk about if you were hoping I would mention something. Thank you all.
If I may, since your image behind you is the Harlequin, and since the Harlequin has shown up in several of the pictures now, if the images are part of the language, what do you suggest is being said with a Harlequin?
That's a great question. Thanks, Larry. The Harlequin is a traditional figure, and I think it's actually a really nice way to talk about this blending of things that Picasso pulls together for us. The Harlequin is a figure from the Commedia dell'arte, which has a long kind of Latin tradition, right, going back to the early Trecento Renaissance era. The Harlequin is usually a figure, though, who is not taken seriously. Artists often kind of occupy that same position as an outsider who, you know, we kind of tend to dismiss or let them get away with something because, like, it's just art. Right? It's just art. And so, but they're always observing. Right? And the Harlequin often takes that role, too, in these classical Commedia dell'arte stories and narratives. And so I think for Picasso, it becomes a way of pointing to tradition. It becomes a way of reflecting on his own position. And it becomes also a recognizable symbol, right? Like, we can look at this painting and know it's the Harlequin because there's also this identifiable diamond pattern that he can play with. He only needs to give us a snippet of cloth and we know who he's talking about. And so I think it's a really great nexus of the personal, the historical, and then the stylistic that kind of comes together.
All right. We have a question over to your right.
Yeah, just a comment. You brought up the issue of the Harlequin, and is that not typically a jester? And a jester, again, typically plays with reality, and that's what you're talking about here, is the way that reality is being played with.
Absolutely.
Wonderful to have that pointed out by the vehicle of the jester.
I mean, and the jester is different than the clown, right? The jester has this proximity to power. The jester is often the kind of critical voice or the revealer of some kind of deception or some kind of intrigue, right? And so it is, it's the figure you don't expect to know that then kind of reveals what's really happening or what's really important. So I love the distinction between a jester and a clown, right? Because there are also clown figures in Picasso's painting. He doesn't consider himself a clown, but he does identify with the figure of the Harlequin as a jester. Thanks for calling that word into the conversation. That's a great one for us to have.
Questions, everything you ever wanted to know about Picasso.
Well, that's a broad net. Yee.
Okay, I'll throw another one out.
Yeah.
Did he lose his hair or did he just shave his head?
He did lose his hair. But it becomes a trademark. So one of the things that, like, I think makes Picasso Picasso is also this very iconic kind of presence. And I will admit, when I was getting dressed this morning, I thought about wearing a striped shirt. And then I decided against that. But he creates this persona and that bald head. I mean, I showed a picture of him from his youth, and this doesn't really look like the Picasso. All the way back here. Like, that's probably not the Picasso that comes to mind, right? And he's very adept at creating a kind of vocabulary of how we recognize him as the artist, right? So that kind of like South of France aesthetic with the Breton shirts or the simple white linens. There are lots of stories of Picasso actually dressing up in costumes to play different characters if he went out for a night. And so like he's aware of costuming as being part of how people respond to him. And I think the bald head is part of that too, right? It speaks not to this kind of like middle class propriety that as a young man he's really trying to achieve, but instead like this kind of timeless figure.
Yes, a question over here to your left.
How many wives did he have?
Wives or mistresses, or there's a lot of ways. There are 7 women, not all of whom he officially married, that are kind of configured as like the chief muses, we'll say. And often scholars kind of define his styles in relationship to who he was with at the time, right? So that, you know, the sort of impoverished years where he's creating the most of the works that we saw today, he's with another painter by the name of Fernand Olivier, and scholars will point to, and this is terrible because I'm just going to keep going back and forth with images, bear with me. This is easier. The Olga image, she was a ballerina. She was a ballet dancer. And she was more sort of upper class than Picasso. And so, for example, the stylistic shift that I frame tonight as being in the context of World War I, other scholars put in the context of like his new sort of middle class respectability, married to this proper woman instead of another painter who was living in poverty, right? So we have this kind of tendency. Then he will leave Olga for Marie-Thérèse, who was a young 15-year-old. That's where we start to get into the problems. And his work changes, and all of a sudden, it's full of these bubbly, young, curvy, balloony kind of figures who are dancing with beach balls on the beach, right? So, like, there is some merit to thinking about his life as chapters of these women.
Wasn't there a period where he was living with his wife and his former mistress while bringing in a third?
There's a lot of overlapping. And again, I think when you get to be a genius, some of those rules don't necessarily apply. Art historians don't enjoy that same kind of licentiousness. But yes, there's a lot of, and this is not just Picasso, right? In mid-century Bohemian rules, perhaps were, or mores were perhaps slightly different.
Yes, a question in the back over here.
Yes, I'm interested in what kind of sculptures he did.
Oh gosh, so many. I could do another hour on sculpture. I mean, I showed just one assemblage that kind of goes into his collage period. But for example, and I can't talk without images. The summer when he is in the south of France and he's working on these paintings, he is also working on a series of sculpted heads, for example, that just like we can see here, he's breaking down these buildings into geometric forms. He's translating the head into these geometric planes, right? And you would think in sculpture, you could just reproduce like what we're looking at in three dimensions, but he's analyzing that three-dimensional form and simplifying it as well. But then there's also like famous examples, like there's, I think, the Picasso in Chicago, where it's like two large perpendicular planes that intersect. As he moves through his career, there's a plethora of sculptural styles he goes through, just as much as I would say the painting. At the heart of it, most of his production is drawing. So it's like, again, impossible to kind of capture all of what Picasso's work looks like in a single way. I recognize that's not the most satisfying answer, though.
A lot of what we see, hear, and read are about critics or other people's opinions. Is there any writings or recordings of what he says his work is about?
That is a great answer. Yes and no. We do have interviews. We do have, I mean, the image that I opened with is actually a still from a video or a series of photographs, excuse me, done for Life magazine where he painted, and I think there is actually video of it as well, where he's like painting with light. And you can see how that worked. He did paintings on glass also that you could kind of like trace and watch him work. He gives interviews, especially in his younger years, that are more useful in understanding his art. But Picasso had one major advantage that not every artist has. When he gets to Paris, and he's beginning in 1906, 1907 to make a sort of reputation for himself, he's approached by Daniel Henry Kahnweiler and offered an exclusive contract. Kahnweiler will buy everything he paints. And then, of course, Kahnweiler turns around and sells it. But it gives Picasso an income. Right. And it also means Picasso doesn't really need to justify his work anymore. Like, he's not trying to sell himself anymore. That's the dealer's job. And so we very quickly see Picasso back away from trying to explain this work. And instead, he gives much more enigmatic answers. You know, like the idea that art is the lie that tells the truth. Like, that's such a pithy and also ambiguous thing to say. And so that gives him a kind of position where he doesn't need to tell us too much about what he's actually up to.
Question here in the front.
How old was Picasso when he passed away?
I could do some quick math. He's born in 1881 and he dies in 1973. And he is working for most of that time. So depending on the time of, I want to say he was 91. Of course.
I will share my favorite story that we always used in my classroom about Picasso. We studied one of his works, a painting he drew during the Spanish Civil War called Guernica. And in Guernica, it is a story, it's a painting that looks like a montage. It's all these shapes and figures and harlequins left and right and all these things. Twisted and anguished people, dead animals. It's following the Germans helping the fascists in Spain by bombing a royalist village. And they bomb the village of Guernica and decimate the village of Guernica. And he draws this picture. He's in World War II in Paris, which was a few years after that. And his studio is being examined by the Nazis, who have taken over in Paris. And as they are examining, one of the SS officers, sees a small replica of Guernica, that famous anti-war poster showing the brutality of the Nazis. And he holds up the card and says, "Did you do this?" And Picasso responds, "No, you did." So when you mentioned the enigmatic answers, I thought of that immediately, him, because you know, he was the one.
I need a microphone, things have changed. He stayed in Paris during World War II?
He did stay in Paris during World War II. He was largely confined to his home and his studio. But at that point, he was, I guess, of sufficient reputation that he was sort of left alone. But yes, he had a studio, I think, on Rue Saint-Augustine, and that's where he was living and working at the time.
I will mention that painting of Guernica is so anti-war that when the Secretary of Defense was going to announce America about to enter one of our recent wars at the United Nations building, because the United Nations had voted to go along with us on this war, the speaker stand was in front of a painting of Guernica. And they suddenly realized you cannot have America announcing a United Nations war standing in front of the greatest anti-war painting ever done. So they brought out portable blue curtains. And they hung the blue curtains in front of Guernica so the television cameras would not see that image behind us as we announced the war.
Sort of famously, Picasso gave Guernica then to Spain, to the country of Spain, under the condition that it would not be in Spain until the era of Franco had passed and democracy had returned. And so this painting lived in New York. It debuted in 1937 at the World's Fair. Right, which was, you know, a prominent international moment for this anti-war statement. And it lived in New York until 1982 when it was returned to Spain.
When Franco finally died.
When we finally have that change of the regime.
All right, other questions for Picasso? We have a question right over there. As we're heading to get that question, I do want to mention that, you know, as she's saying, there's a lot of material about Picasso, a lot of paintings you have not seen, artwork you have not seen. In the back of the room, the library has put their Picasso assorted collection back there, not just for us to look at, but for those who would like to check out a book, they are at your disposal. And I know the other day I was here at the library and I could not find my library card. It was sitting by the bed at home somewhere. And they were able to use my driver's license and pull up my file and check out a book. Even if you don't happen to have your card with you, if you have an account, you can still check out a book. Yes.
I remember Antonio Banderas talking about how he was going to make that movie about Picasso, but I never was aware of when it came out or where it was shown. Have you seen it?
I've seen parts of it. It was shown, as I understand, on the National Geographic Channel. So it was a mini series rather than like a theatrical release. It's probably available somewhere online, but I have not watched
National Geographic Channel is broadcast through Disney Plus, so it might be on Disney Plus.
It might be in their catalog.
Yeah.
I would say it came out probably in 2016 or 17, just based on when I started using that image with my classes. Because I had the National Geographic magazine, like I brought in.
All right. And as we wrap things up, unless there's another question, I do want to remind you that now that you know the basics of Picasso, you have a chance to speak with Picasso in February. What's the date in February? So 8, 9, 10, and 11, we'll be doing Picasso shows, the Winter Chautauqua Festival. Come out and see it. We're going to be in Simpsonville. We're going to be back at Wade Hampton High School. We got all that straightened out. Simpsonville Arts Center and the Spartanburg Library. So, and I think, are they doing two shows there at the Spartanburg Library? So lots of chances to see them. Come out and see the performer, ask the questions, see what foolishness Picasso is up to. And as always, I thank you guys for coming out tonight. I hope you found something of interest and that you will continue to pursue this. Thank you so much.